best for last, but we're kind of saving the best for last. Right? Okay, we're all on the same page with that. Yeah, that's a round of applause. Questions on the floor. So once I throw to the floor, just raise your hand, use your good loud voice so everybody can hear, and I'll try to get to as many questions as possible. Cool?
Cool.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's go. You know her and love her as a companion, Martha Jones from Doctor Who. Please welcome.
Supportive and welcoming, so yeah.
Well, speaking of Doctor Who, what do you think it is about this show, you know, and all of its different versions, that why has it lasted so long?
Well, I think, like, when I have people coming up to me in my line and they say, oh, Martha was my favourite,
yeah.
Or sometimes my, this is one of my favourite things, so you ask the smaller kids, who's your favourite companion? And they can go, Amy. Amazing! So actually, what I like is that for every regeneration of the Doctor, for every new companion, it's going to reach different people for different reasons, yeah. And that just brings more people to the fold, and it just makes the community that is Doctor Who just grow in a new direction.
What is your opinion on, I guess he's not super new anymore, but what do you think about Michael Holmes, the Doctor? Our current Doctor.
I love him. I mean, I don't, like, okay, here's the deal. I know, so this is some of you in the line already, but, so I watched all of Billy's, all of my season,
yep.
All of Catherine Tate's season, and then my life and my work and my job start taking me off in different directions. I travel a lot and do stuff, I wasn't at home. So I actually just fell out of the order of watching Doctor Who. And so I dipped in, like, in Jenna's season. I was watching it, my brother's watching it too. He was like, oh, who's she? Again, I was like, brother, just support for me. So anyway, he was watching it for her. And I was literally going, I was like, and Peter's brilliant, and she's brilliant actress. I didn't know what was going on. So I was live tweeting with it, and fans were saying, I was like, what? When did Cybermen move at that speed of light? That was how they were moving, you know, in my day. A decade ago. People like, yeah, don't you know? Now they do this, now they do that. And I was like, oh god. And I was going, what are they talking about? And this bit, I think what's happened now is it's become quite serialized,
yeah.
I think. Whereas when I was doing it, they were quite standalone. So that was the only episode I saw of Peter and Jenna. And I think he's, for my money, he's absolutely fantastic.
Yeah.
He's an excellent actor. He brings a completely different quality to it. He's doing all the things you're supposed to do. You're, certain elements that you kind of maintain and certain things that you want to mix up so you keep it fresh. So I think he's doing an excellent job, but that's a very long answer to say, and I don't watch enough of it now to
yeah.
sort of go, the reasons I prefer X is because of Y.
Yep.
But he's going down wonderfully, isn't
yeah. he? Well, there's a new companion. So, yeah. I mean, what advice would you give a new companion going into Doctor Who?
Ooh.
I know, I'm pulling up the hard questions.
Do you know what, though? I kind of feel like everyone's experience must be really unique.
Yeah, everyone has a different experience on the show.
I really
yeah, their character.
Depends where you are in your life as an actor. I think it depends on what you're being asked to do as a character. You have only so much I don't want to say control, because that's the wrong word, that makes it sound like it's like a close shot. But it is quite, it's a well-oiled machine.
Yeah.
I kind of liken it to a steaming train that's going 100 miles an hour, and you, your contribution is to jump on, you stay on for a few stations, you jump off.
Yeah.
And so that train is going to keep going before you, after you, and you know. And so when people jump on, like, I guess my analogy is it depends on what point of the journey that train is at, which will reflect what kind of experience you have. Like, for example, when I was doing it, we never really travelled. When we were in New York, we were like kind of green screen backdrop. Really? We were like across for the Statue of Liberty. And then the years after, they're like flying to actually shoot
yeah.
in the locations because the show grew, and they could do that.
Mm-hmm.
So my experience would be very different to Karen and so. So I would just tell her, roll with it, keep your head, you know, at clad feet on the ground, and just enjoy it as well, because you can get a lot of, you can feel the pressure in some way, but actually you just have to have a good time, because that does come across. Yeah.
Okay, well, let's just get rid of Martha then. I mean, we have our own reasons why we were in love with her, why yeah. she's our favorite. What did you love about Martha?
I liked the breakdown of her when I first got it. She was very much pitched as, and did demonstrate a lot of strength. She's very intelligent, courageous, and I feel like she was different to Rose in the sense that Rose seemed like she was waiting for something to come along and take her life to somewhere where she wanted it to be. Whereas Martha was like, I'm in medical school, yeah. I'm paying my rent, I'm looking after my family, I'm falling apart, I've got things to do. And this doctor came along and took her on this journey that I think she was having to kind of work out, and then of course the feelings were involved. So I kind of loved all what she stood for. We did get the whole forlorn, lovelorn storyline, which persisted quite, you know, for some time, right, over her arc. Personally, as a performer, I loved it when she was demonstrating that strength and that intelligence. Yeah, I like that she had that vulnerability. You know, but I can see people's frustration and slight irritation, you know, with the lack of character development slightly. I think if I was to ever go back, it would only be to develop her, which was we were potentially going to do if I went to Torchwood, but the dates didn't work out for that, so I was doing Law and Order, so that didn't happen, but, you know, the universe is, there's no time limits to any of it, so it could be the Smiths go in later on if ever it came back, and I think she would need some kind of growth and development. But she's, I like that about her, that she wore her heart on her sleeve, and if she felt it, you know, she would say it.
Yeah.
And so it made her very honest, and I think she was a good girl.
Well, speaking of Law and Order, so my mom's a huge Doctor Who fan, so when she found out I was getting to moderate the panel, she's like, oh my god, Law and Order! I just absolutely adored you, yeah.
What did you like about working on that show?
Okay, so with something like Doctor Who, when I was growing up, it was just about to go into its hiatus. So my doctor was Sylvester McCoy, we watched it for maybe a year and then it was gone.
Okay.
So I did not grow up with Doctor Who.
Yeah.
So the kind of, where David Tennant and Russell T Davies and Phil Constable were coming from were pure fanboy.
Yeah.
You know, when we were doing it, they were like, oh my god, I can't believe we're actually part of this show that it's meant so much to us growing up. And I never had it growing up. Mm-hmm. So I didn't have, I was coming from a different angle. Whereas with something like Law and Order, when that came out, particularly up to season 3, like 1, 2, 3, Jill Halfpenny was watching, but I want to be like her. And so when it came out, I called my agent and I was like, I'd love to be involved with this. I'd absolutely love it. And it was such a departure from Martha as well, who's quite full of energy and, you know, just kind of dynamic, and then to play this character, Alicia, that was straight and steady and very much of a different energy. That's something that's important to me as an actor, to kind of keep diversifying and keep trying different things. And I've been lucky enough over the last few years to do that.
Are we speaking since 8?
Yeah.
So I'm going to ask, what's it like working with Wachowskis?
Oh my god. That was another one, actually, when my agent called up and said, so Netflix is doing this new show, it's the Wachowskis. Like, you would have to know me to know how much the Matrix changed. It did for everybody, but it really, I think at the time I was kind of, my mum's Muslim, my dad's Methodist, I went to a Catholic school, and we get to that point sometimes in our lives where we start questioning, like, who are we, and where are we coming from, and religion, am I religious? I tried to be Buddhist for a while, and, you know, you just kind of dabbling in different things, and then the Matrix comes, and go, okay, so now we can start thinking about science and religion together, and where are we, who are we, what do we stand for? So we really started, it came at a point in my life where I was doing a lot of self-processing, and I was like, thank you for giving us some food for thought.
Yeah.
And then Keanu Reeves and Carrie Ann Moss just looked super sexy on top of that.
Oh, mate, it's all about wanting to be, you know, in something like that.
Yeah. The film is more than just a film, it meant so much to me. So when she called and said Netflix is doing this thing with Wachowskis, sometimes you have to not allow yourself to get too excited, because then the drop when you don't hear, when you don't get it, you know, it kind of always hurts every time. You start to get more able to control how badly it looks, but it still hurts when you get the rejection. So, and actually with Doctor Who, I didn't know I was auditioning for Doctor Who.
What?
So they didn't tell me, and actually I appreciated that, because that probably would have been another one
the pressure.
You overthink it. So with this one, they were like, it's the Wachowskis, it's Netflix, and I was like, yeah, I would really like to do that. And I said to her, I'm just going to try and keep myself cool, but I'm going to audition for it.
and see how it goes. We did my first audition with the casting director, and she was great. Like, you do different castings where some of them really empower you and make you feel like they're rooting for you, yeah. And some of them sit there like that. So she was like, come on, she's like, yeah, she had props. She's like, let's use these books, and you come from there, and you can sit on this chair. So actually, when we're doing it, it felt like a small theatre performance. Because you're like, oh, I'm actually acting in the casting. Usually you just feel like it's an exercise in reciting.
Yeah.
And I was doing it, and she was getting involved, and I was like, oh, I love you, Kate. So I felt that the audition went well.
Okay.
And then the next stage was, they wanted to know my dates and whether I would be available, and I was doing the Cowrie Diaries.
I love that. We have you going home enough.
That was again an amazing experience and quite a different role.
Yeah, you have had so many different roles.
And so they said CW couldn't tell them if the show was going to go again or not. So I kind of was like, please, because I feel like they may be inquiring, they're interested. Anyway, the dates kind of just worked out. And they're like, hey, you would essentially be available, but you're going to have a Skype meeting with the Wachowskis. And no, wait, for the plus, that was a chemistry test with another actress with the Wachowskis. And I was like, oh my God. And they say never meet your heroes. And I remember sitting outside the room thinking, I really want to come out of this room as in love with them as I am. I go in, like, please. Oh, I can't tell you. But they are everything and more. They're such generous people. And they're interested in people. That's the whole thing. They write about the human condition, don't they? And actually, when they're talking to you, it looks like they're looking in you.
Into your soul.
Yeah. And you feel like you could be spouting complete nonsense, and they really empower you. That's a good call. So, and they're incredibly erudite, incredibly intelligent, and just great people. So I walked in this room, we did this chemistry test. Again, I thought it went okay. And then the next day, there was a Skype meeting with them, and it was a record at 6, and I was like, oh. And they told me in that meeting that I got it, and I was overjoyed. And then they say in this business, the best time is getting the news that you've got a job. That's the most exciting moment, because everything after that point is reality.
Yeah.
And you've actually got to go and do the job, and you're like, then you're plagued with, can I do it? How's it going to go down? And then when I got the script as well, I was like, this is gonna push me.
Because yes.
I've never played a character that's been in a love relationship. Period.
Really?
Oh yeah, like I've never been in a relationship in a show.
Yeah.
So actually kind of depicting the genuine love, like something I wanted to make sure was gonna go down, right, let alone the underrepresentation of LGBTQ relationships on television. Yeah. I was like, this has to be good.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you something, it has pushed me, and I've learned so much, and I feel so empowered. They've done nudity before, and they've done sex scenes before, and they've done anything before, and you think, I felt like I was in a safe environment to grow.
Wow, for your first time taking all those chances, that's amazing.
Yeah, it was good. I love that show.
Cool. Okay, well, I'm going to stop pausing now. Okay.
No, I didn't actually. I went in season 2, I think, and I was in a scene with David at Torchwood. I didn't meet Billy at that time. And I just remember, David was so nice. I got home, I was speaking to my agent, saying everyone was so welcoming, and it felt like a good day at work. And then I remember on like day 4 or something, I was just there on set, and the producer came down. Russell T, you know who everyone is, Judy Garner, Russell T. Davis, Bill Collison. They all came down and they were like, and it was somebody else. But they wanted to like just meet me. And I was like, gosh, this is, I've never had that before. as a guest on a show, only for one episode, and you meet the whole team. And I was like, that's unusual.
Yeah.
And I didn't know that at that time they were already scouting for people, because at that time they already knew that Billy was leaving, but it hadn't been made public knowledge. So, when I auditioned for the part of Adeola, What the casting director went back and said was that, because they wanted me to audition for two different characters, and they were quite different. And I remember, sometimes when you walk out of an audition, you know you've done all right.
Yeah.
Sometimes you walk out and you just want to go stick your head like in yes. the ground, and like, it's all so embarrassing. And that one, that you got to do two completely different characters, and I'm thinking, oh, that went all right, actually. And I feel like I didn't embarrass myself. And so apparently they wanted to come down, they were starting to scout people who they felt could, you know, play this part. So anyway, that's what was happening, but I didn't know. And then when I auditioned for Martha, they told me it was for Torchwood. And they said, this is a new spin-off of Doctor Who, it's called Torchwood. We don't have any script for it, but here is episode one of Doctor Who called Rose. So you can read from this.
I still didn't even twig. I was just like, okay.
So they were, you know, they were putting everything in place to try and meet people and get someone ready so that when the announcement was made, they would say, we've got someone lined up. So yeah, everything's so top secret with that show. Even when you're going through the process, you don't always know you're going through the process. Yeah, it's quite secretive.
So when you were the companion, like your first day on set, like what was that like?
Oh yeah, that was, it was wonderful. Everyone was so nice. I remember the guy that drove me to the studios, you know, his job was to drop me to the studio and that was that. And we've become good friends now, actually. But he parked the car, held my hand, and he took me right up to the stage where we were shooting. And maybe you could see I was a little bit nervous. And it was nice. Yeah. And I was like, thank you. Because I don't know anybody here. And here I'm coming into this big old thing. Yeah. And it's, and so that set the tone for me. His kindness set the tone. And then you get onto a set like Doctor Who, and actually, David set a good tone. He was always very up,
yeah,
and always very positive, never complained. And I think that has a knock-on effect. You know, if someone's grumbling yeah. all the time, everybody just wants to go home. So it was a wonderful first day, and the whole shoot continued like that. It was a great night out in Cardiff, and it was quite an experience.
Such nice memory, that's amazing.
Yeah.
With John Bowerman.
Oh, cool. I adore him. It was great when he came on for those last couple of episodes of season three. Excuse me, my voice going.
Sounds awesome.
So he brought a whole new dynamic as well, because, you know, when you're the companion and the doctor, you're in all day, every day, and it's just the two of you most of the time. You've got all the guests coming and going, but it's the two of you. So when John came along, suddenly there was the three of us. So we'd go to all the occasions together, hang out together, do this, do that. And they both have great advice about the business as well. They've been doing it a while, and for someone who was new to it all, they were really helpful. But he brought a really different dynamic, you know. David was the grown-up on stage. John was not. But it all, you know, everyone, you know, we all bounced off each other, so that was a lot of fun. We were both working for the CW at the same time, but we never ended up at the same events, we never crossed over, we keep in touch on social media, and just seeing him here today was the first time in like 7 years. So oh, we're going to do a picture thing tomorrow, photo session tomorrow, but it's not on the schedule, because it's just, it's nice to catch up with somebody after such a long time and realise that they haven't fundamentally changed, you know.
Yeah.
It's nice, it's something you can meet people after years and,
yeah,
it's not the same, but
yeah.
He's a good boy.
Thank you.
Well, not really.
Well, you said it, girl.
First of all, I have to say thank you for taking the time this morning. As someone who is feeling very uncomfortable in their own skin this morning, you really turned the day around. They may say don't meet your heroes, but I did, and I'm more impressed now than this morning. I know for me, the hardest scene to watch in Sense8 was when Jamie Clayton's character ends up in the hospital. Mm-hmm. And I literally didn't think I'd be able to finish the series after that. What was the hardest scene for you to film, and what was the most fun?
Just so everyone heard about what was the most fun and hardest scene to shoot for Sensi. Okay.
With Noni, with Jamie Clayton's character, Lana Wachowski is putting a lot of her own experiences into that character. My character Anita is based quite heavily on her partner, Karen Winslow, and Jamie is playing Lana, essentially. So some days are hard, because when you as an artist are pouring so much of yourself and reopening old wounds, there's a lot of emotion. So there's a lot of tears when we're shooting, because it's hard. She's amazing. You know, a lot of us, I think, we go through life, we have experiences, if they hurt, we look to try and get as far away from them as possible and heal. But she sees it as her responsibility as an artist to keep those wounds open in a way that's going to be helping other people. So there are a lot of tears because it's someone's real life. And then there's a lot of laughter, and there's a lot of love. They are good people, and they don't understand why we can't just all get along. And their stories are about that. It's about the human condition. Is there such a thing as that binds us all together? And our difference is just geographical and, you know, cultural. It's all things that we can overcome if we want to. Actually, you just have to love. So a lot of laughter. They're really great at every country or city they rap in. They do a rap party. So I mean, they've visited 19 countries this year. And that's a big shoot, and they will rap in every single one to thank the crew, thank the cast, and thank that they hire locally when they go places. They are just people loving people. And so I feel like this being part of that company is enriching my life in so many ways.
Wow.
Awesome.
What's your favorite episode when you were a companion? Like, which one did you have the most fun on?
So favorite episode
of Doctor.
Yeah, and also, did you enjoy getting to play kind of like a Cyberman when you were a doula?
Yeah, I did actually. That's always fun. It's always quite nice being baddies. Yes, so favorite episodes. Well, again, I was saying to somebody in the line earlier, in season 3, and certainly before that as well, a little bit afterwards, I feel like each of the episodes were more standalone, and they had completely different genres and completely different feelings, and so I would get something out of every single one. It was so exciting opening the script and going, what century are we in? Where, who, how, what? So that was always, every episode offered something. But I would say I really connected with, it's a choice of two, Smith and Jones, because it was the first as well, and I love it. That's fantastic, and I love Shakespeare, and we got to film in the Globe, we had it to ourselves in the middle of the night, and we'd be able to sneak off and think, you know, you'd never be able to do that if it was a normal day at the theatre. So again, you feel quite privileged that you get these behind the scenes access to places that you might not on a day-to-day basis. So yeah, either of those two.
Cool.
Okay, way in the back, yes. Oh, that's you, yeah.
Hi.
I'll go here
after. So, I'm a female working in a mostly male-dominated field. People seem to ask me all the time how that feels. So now I'm going to ask you a very similar question. Because a lot of people say Doctor Who is in some way quite sexist, where you always have these female companions running around after a male doctor. But your character is very different. She was a doctor herself, even the hospital scene, she's looking after it, and then she eventually leaves because she doesn't want to stay with the doctor.
People seeing representations of themselves. So, I mean, my sister works for Ofcom, who are like the regulators of British television, and we sit there and talk about that. And there's a lot of initiatives that are being carried out at the moment that you're kind of going to have to force people, and that's shocking. You have to force some networks to take in a certain quota. You have to force them to shoot some drama in certain locations so that you get access to different kinds of people. And that's kind of sad. You go, oh, wow, you actually have to push them into it. But you know what? It's better to do that than all sit back and just not see what we want to see on our screens. To Russell, because I read that in the script, and I was like, oh, right. So make him off look a bit fickle. Okay, where's Tom? I thought they were engaged. And he said, yeah, well, I kind of thought it was great that your first episode was called Smith and Jones. He said, I find it kind of great that at the end of my tenure, I'm tying up all the characters, and I want you to end up being Martha Smith Jones. He said, <"Full> but seriously, he was aware that he was leaving, and he did want to feel like he could keep some of the character storylines going together. So should anything else happen in the future, you know, it's not like some characters are going to be sidelined. We were both supposed to go to Torchwood together, actually, as a couple, but the BBC was, because they couldn't commit to how many episodes they wanted to do, when it was going to go out. There was no answers to any of it.
Well, then the BBC has to bring back Torchwood.
They were. Was based on the physical. Do you think she would still have that torch? I mean, when we're attracted to people, how much of it is what on what? You know, I feel like the physical does play quite a lot of it, but I guess she would have to get to know him. I think she's a good woman, and I think, you know, other than flitting around between Tom and integrity, and she would, but she's grown up and she's kind of, you know, grown beyond that. So I think she would. I think they would get on just.
Among the characters that you have portrayed, which one do you share the most traits with?
Yeah.
So among all the characters you play, which one do you share the most traits with?
Well. Martha is, she is very family orientated, which I am. She's a caretaker, which I feel like I am. That's probably coming from more of a control freak. Make sure I'm taken care of. And so I would say I have some similarities there with her. I don't wear my heart on my sleeve as much. I wouldn't. If I like someone, they don't. They're usually the last to know. I knew my now fiancé for 14 years, and it took me 8 to actually tell him that I need to be my go out on a date. Maybe it's okay, I'm not very good at kind of like putting my heart out there. So I would say the similarities, differences there. I think Alicia, Law and Order. Too centered. I think I'm a bit more of a hot mess. Larissa, off the wall. I liked her honesty. I like to think I can be honest without being rude. I find that that's tricky. I mean, I love the honesty of children because you know it's not coming from a mean place. And actually, it's so nice to hear the truth sometimes. We have to be careful how we package that up and give it. An Aminata, like, I wish I could be like her. She's like my alter ego. When I look at her, I think that is who I wish I could be, someone so sure about all of it. And so confident. And it's nice being an actor because you get to explore so many facets of yourself or your alter self, like there. The fact that she wears practically no clothes all the time, you know, these are not things I could ever really do in my real life. I'm just so like, oh. And she gives me that freedom. So, I'm loving that. Sometimes I feel like it's not always about identifying with the character. It's just, as long as you can find a key to connect with them, I think that you help them come across to the audience.
Cool. Good question. Okay, way over there. Yeah.
Do you have any like fun or funny moments from on set that like really stick in your mind, whether it be from like Doctor Who or show that I can't remember? Can't say. There we go.
There you go.
That's 10 years ago. Yes, there were very many crazy, strange days. I feel like more happened on Torchwood, which you could. I remember going from Doctor Who, because where we filmed both shows, I don't know how many of you did in the studios, going like that, but where we used to film was called Upper Boat. And the Doctor Who set, like the interior of the TARDIS, was right next to the hub of Torchwood. And so it was really interesting going from one to the other because it would feel like an extension of the same part, of the same job. Rather, it was the same part, an extension of the same job. You go from one to the other. But the atmosphere was quite different each time. I remember coming with Doctor Who and being like, you know, it was a fun place to be, but it was very in control, like, you know, you hit your time limits, and there was a lot to do, and it was all like, it was a well-oiled machine. And I went from there into Torchwood, and it was like I was in a Big Brother house. What is this? I literally got in, like, John said to me today, after we were rolling around on the floor in the green room, he was like, God, you're so less conservative now, did you know? Yeah. So like, you know, come on guys, let's not mess around. We've got like 10 minutes to get this tape. And meanwhile they're like laughing, crying, doing real practical jokes with each other when it was someone else's single, and I was standing there going, I don't know how I can keep it straight. Like how?
Yeah.
There's one scene where Naoko was supposed to be crying and the rest of them in the back with their asses. Oh sorry, oh no. bottom. You know, elbow, they're like farting or doing whatever, it's just doing this emotional thing. And she's holding him. And I'm looking at her going, thinking, oh God, I bet when they say cut, she's going to be like, guys, stop listening to my single. But as soon as they say cut, she starts falling about laughing with them. And then they're going to be trailer for Cake. And I'm so proud of my So they were like, whacking. And then after I was there for like a week, I realised it was okay to actually just be a bit more loose and have fun. They were just having to hit their targets too. They were delivering their rushes in on time, they were doing their thing, but it was their playground, yeah. And they were enjoying it, so a lot of fun.
That's cool that you guys experience both.
Yeah, yeah.
Different types of sets, you know?
Definitely.
It's back here.
If you had the chance to do a trip on the TARDIS, would you rather go in the past or visit an alien planet?
Do you know what's interesting? Every time I ask somebody that, when we just generally talk about it, I think people more often than not say, like even if I don't flag past the present, say where would you go if it's a time machine? And they go, well, I would go back to so and so. And there's
something.
I would
rather go on an alien planet.
Go for it. Yeah, yeah. Well, of course. But what comes with that, though? The unknown comes with that. And I think human nature is to again control is to kind of be like, well, if I go back, I have the knowledge of what I'm going to get, so I'd like to experience it, but I know what I'm going to get. It takes a very different kind of person, I think, to go, I'm going to go forward. upside, back, you know, not backwards, anyway, but backwards, without knowing what you're going to get. I find that says a lot more about you than it does
you.
I would probably go back.
Anywhere in your childhood or like back before then?
Childhood was fun.
It was
a good time. And actually, you don't really realize how easy you have it, do you? That's why our parents always trying to bang it into us, aren't they? Just enjoy yourself. Don't rush to grow up. I mean, this, especially now with the social media and all that, the kind of rush to grow up. I remember I was saying to them, can I shave my legs yet? She was like, no, you're a child. When do I get to? I just want to do grown up
things. I remember saying that too. Like, don't start.
Don't start. And I was like, when then? Yeah. When you're a teenager. The day I turned 13. Razor out. There's blood everywhere. But I did it.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think if I could go back, I would just take a little bit more time.
Furthest in the back.
That's horrible. I'm so sorry.
Yes, gentlemen, yes.
When you were talking earlier about the Martha Jones art, I thought that one of the important episodes for that was the Dogs of Manhattan one.
Right.
With some of the stuff near the end, training to be a doctor almost in a way. What was your memories of filming that episode? Did you like
the Daleks in Manhattan, the pig soldiers and all that. That was a fun one. What did we... Oh, that fluctuates between being really fun and really difficult. There was a lot of night shoots. That was predominantly night shot, and we were in like swampy bog forests. And it was cold. It could be moaning. Oh, it was cold. No, it wasn't. It was, it was hard. I remember some really tough shoots. I mean, I loved working with Miranda Raisin and Andrew Garfield. He was brilliant. I mean, you know when you kind of see somebody even at that stage in their career, and he was young and he was doing this Southern American so confidently and swaggery, and you just go, he's going
somewhere.
Lovely way. So those two were great fun to work with, and I remember. It's hard, isn't it? Because you're never sure what memories are bleeding in from actually a different time that you were there. But I remember those two particularly, and I'm still in touch with Miranda Raisin years later. And we talked about bingo. We're both big bingo fans. Love a bit of bingo. It was always great. It's nice to have that one person, like if you have David, or if you're in a show where there's two of you. It's nice to have that consistency, but it's also fabulous to get different energy coming in, and all the guests, and they were always really high caliber, really, really professional, really interested people. So that was a real high point for that one. The people that came on in.
Cool.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
How was it recording the part where Martha was cloned?
Oh,
in season 4.
Yeah, the cloning, that was kind of interesting, because we saw the stunt guy do it first, and they were like, okay, so, and he had to do it with a complete face mask on, because when he comes out as the clone, he's got no defined features, right? So we had this face mask on, and they submerged him in the gloop, and he sort of comes out, rises up, all in control, and I was like, oh, that looks doable, okay, right?
Yeah.
So you're going to get in. We're going to have you under the water, under the gloop, and it stank funny. It was like some stuff. And I was like, what is this? And they're like, no, it's fine. You're just going to sit in there, and then put your head under it, and you just... They said, you're not going to hear, be able to hear us say action, because you're going to have gloop in your ears. So they said, you'll feel the tapping on the side of the tin when it's time to come up. I was like, okay, so... and of course, you can't hold anything, because you're going to come up like that. So I just had to go down like this, and I just held my breath. Felt the tapping, and then, but because I had my eyes closed under there, and I timed it all a bit wrong, I just started rising up, and I took a breath before I'd come out with the glue. So it shot down up my nose and down up my throat. I feel like if you watch that scene and you focus on my throat, you can see it go, Even though I kept my face perfectly still. On the inside, I was moving, please take up, because I'm not going to spit glue on it. And then they said cut, and I literally was like, bah! And I was like, please, I don't want to have to do it again, but I thought there's no way they were going to buy that tape. It must look terrible. And they were like, cut, yes, you got that, moving on.
So say, I feel Martha was the most cheated companion, that she had so much more potential that she didn't get to fulfill. I wanted to see so much more out of her, just even that in that season. I just felt that there were so many two-parters and so many things that I wanted to see much more out of Martha.
Yeah.
So she's one of my favorite companions, but again, I wanted to see so much more from her. But onto the question, having worked with Chris Chibnall, what do you think he's going to bring when he becomes showrunner on Who?
Well, first and foremost, he's a lifelong fan, which I think is important because you have a real sense of pride and kind of, you know, you want to do right by it. You want to do right by fans. You know what it's like to be a fan. You kind of know what you want to see. And I think actually he's been he was always quite involved in it, but on a writer level. So I feel like he would have been in a lot of meetings, he would have been privy to a lot of conversations, and whether he ever knew he was going to be showrunner one day or not, I think he would have picked up a lot of things along the way. And so I think he will implement all of that. I worked with him on Law and Order as well, so I can vouch for him, what kind of person he is. He's incredibly receptive, he's incredibly approachable. So I feel like he would be available and listen to what people kind of want him as well. Very intelligent. So I think it's in really safe hands. He's a good guy. I like him. He's very talented. When did we find out? I mean, we were all howling. Like, you're that big face man. We were like, wait, what? How did that happen? maybe again, you know, talking about what Russell said about the whole Mickey and Martha thing, it's quite nice, isn't it, when you get a connection between two characters. It's nice for the audience, it's nice for the actors, it's nice for the characters. So that's quite special. And to combine those two very special characters into one, especially when, isn't it, when Captain Jack is talking about it, he says, I was, you know, the pretty boy, the face of it all, and then you kind of want to see that journey, how you go from pretty boy to baby. It's a beautiful big face. I love the, again, this is testament to the whole team. The animatrix, the CGI, the prosthetics, the amount of people that did a lot of brilliant work. And I was kneeling this close in one of the scenes to the face of Bone. Detail, you know, the 100 levers they have that move one bit of eyelid and one side of his mouth. The voice is so warm and comforting from him as well. So I love that he's both of those. I think it's about we laughed, but actually it's such a wonderful combining of two well-loved characters.
Okay, we only have time for one more question. Okay, right back there, yeah.
Yeah. Hi. Yeah, that's a great question, actually. I feel like if you look at the the arc of season three. I do definitely feel like there's quite an obvious turning point, like I think it's in 42, so it's halfway through, roughly, where she gets given the key to the TARDIS. And I feel like at that point there is a bit of a shift in the dynamic. So she first gets on, he's very much in control, he's very much the boss, he's taking her places, and she's there to learn. And I think at that point there's a definite shift, and then it becomes quite a literal shift in roles, where he doesn't remember who he is, and she is taking care of him, and looking out for him.
Yeah.
And I think that, you know, the sort of love, the unrequited love story was quite prevalent, but I think what actually, if you look at it, what they developed was a really wonderful friendship that was codependent. And I feel that it looks like it was sort of very one-sided, but they needed each other for different things, and I think it's great. I remember filming that last scene actually, and I think when we get to that point where they feel they have mutual appreciation and mutual respect for each other, and she's going to deal with the fact that it's a one-way street love-wise, and she chooses to leave. I remember when I was filming it, we shot that quite near the end of the whole wrapping of the season anyway. So it was going to be changing or moving, you know, Russell was leaving, da, 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 da. There was lots of changes going on. And I remember filming it, so we were all really emotional anyway. And every time I shot the scene, I would cry. But it was actually, it wasn't just sort of a character choice. I was feeling that, you know, it's coming to an end of an era, and you just kind of go, this has been on Earth, you don't know if you're going to see it. And it was the whole thing. So the director kept running in and going, I've been given really strong instructions that there are to be no tears. And I was like, I'm not making a choice, it's just happening. And okay, can we try again? And I remember at the time going, God, but like, if I'm feeling it, like, and that's what I feel. And it was exactly the right thing, because she has to be stronger. She is stronger when she leaves. Doesn't mean it's hurting any less, but she has to reconcile it, and she has to grow, and she has to move on. So it was the right decision. I really remember the time going, I think it should be, you know, it's a painful moment, but it's amazing the amount of people that have come up to me, even today, that have said, that moment helped me get out of a relationship, be it abusive, be it whatever, mentally, I didn't need to be there, I couldn't get out, and it gave me the impetus to do that. And that's generally go, well, sometimes